Well, good morning. Good morning. It is good to be here with you as we celebrate Holy Trinity Sunday. And we've looked at the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, but also we are going to be looking at things that the Holy Trinity has sent us to do. What is it that God has given us to do, that He has sent us out? And we're going to be looking a bit at that as well. But it's good to be here with you. I'm Pastor Kurt Steinbrueck with Faith Lutheran Church in Wesley Chapel, and we're glad to have you here worshiping with us. In order to help you worship with us, we have a bulletin available, both online and downloadable, if you want to print it out, whatever works best for you. Hopefully there's a link that will be placed in, if you're on Facebook or YouTube. You can also go to faithwesleychapel.com. That's faithwesleychapel.com, and you can find the order of service there. It's in a blog post. It should be the most recent blog post, but also you can find it even, there's a link to a page right there on the home page. So if you're watching the video on our website, you can actually see it right there below that video. So you can follow that, or you can find that so you can follow along with the service. There's lots of things that we do in the service where I want to encourage you to actively participate in it. We're going to sing some songs. We're going to have some parts of the service that are responsive. And so I would encourage you to do all those things just like if you were in a sanctuary and we were all together in person. You know, do that same thing in home. It just helps immensely with the experience of worship as you go through this. So you can find those there, and hopefully that's something that you are able to find by now. I'm trying to buy a little time here to make sure that everyone has time to find that. And actually, if you wouldn't mind, post a little something in Facebook if you want to let me know if you can hear this well. I've got a little bit different audio setting going on, so just let me know that you can hear everything if you don't mind. So we're going to go ahead and get started, and I'm very glad to be here with you this morning. Let's open up with prayer, and then we'll get into our opening song. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the grace and the mercy that you give us each and every day. Lord, you tell us that your mercies are new every morning. And so today, Lord, we gather around your word. We gather around your word to hear about Jesus, to hear what you have done for us, to hear your words of forgiveness, to teach us, to also have words of comfort and strength that we need, especially in this time, Lord. And we pray that you would be with us, that you would silence all the distractions around us and help us to hear you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to start with our opening hymn, which is 10,000 Reasons. Bring that up. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Heavenly Father asks us to come into His presence, but we are sinful and unworthy. Yes, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but Jesus Christ died on the cross that we may be forgiven and washed clean of all of our sins by His blood spilled on the cross. Lord, if you wash us, we will certainly be clean and pure. We take a moment to bow before His cross and silently reflect on our lives and confess our sins. Let us confess together our sins before our God and Father. Heavenly Father, we confess that we are sinners. We have sinned against you and our neighbors. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not shared the gospel in our community as we should. We justly deserve your punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, let's join together in our song of praise and thanksgiving, which is Christ is Risen. Our first reading for today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2, first with verse 14, and then continuing on verses 22 to 36. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. Men of Judah and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and give ear to my words. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders, and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David said concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will also dwell in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life, and you make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, may I say to you with confidence about the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we all are witness. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into heaven, but he himself says, My Lord said to my Lord, Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus, whom you crucified. This is the gospel of our Lord. All right, we're going to continue on with a children's message. And so I'd like all the kids to come on up, come to your device, iPad, television, whatever it is you're watching on. Bring the kids up. This is for you. Hey, how you doing? Cool. All right, here we go. Hold on a second. How are you? How are you doing today? I was just about to watch a movie. Can you guess what movie that is? It's Star Wars. In fact, this is Star Wars, A New Hope. It's the first Star Wars movie that ever came out. It's one of my favorite movies. It's an awesome movie. It's got space battles, and it's got sword fights, and it's got all kinds of things. It's funny, and it's exciting, and all these things put together. And it's a really, really fun movie, really great movie. If you haven't seen it, you might want to talk to your parents about seeing that. It's a really cool movie. You know, I could tell you all about it. I could tell you all about the characters and all the things that go on in the movie because you know, I really enjoyed the movie and I remember those things. What's your favorite movie? What do you think? Do you like comedies? Do you like action movies and exciting adventures?
What kind of movies do you like? Yeah, well, you know how you tell people about things like that? You know how you go watch a movie and you're like, oh, I gotta go tell someone because this was the greatest movie ever. And you're just telling everybody, hey, I saw this movie and I loved it and this is what happened. And you talk about all these different things, the characters and everything. Right? We do that because we get excited about it and we want to share it. The interesting thing to me is that we can do that with Jesus too. It's really the same thing. It's kind of like if you meet a new friend and you want to tell people about the new friend you met, or you went on vacation, you want to tell people about the vacation you went on. Well, we can tell people about Jesus too. And in fact, it's even better because then people can get to know Jesus, and that can change lives. That can be huge. So we can tell people about Jesus just like we do about movies or anything like that. So what do we tell them? With the movie, you're telling them the plot, you're telling them the characters. It's kind of the same type of thing, and it's not really that hard. We can say, you know what? God created everything. He created the grass behind your house. He created the ocean. He created the mountains. He created space and stars and all those great things. And he created you and me. And then he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to us. Why? Why did he send his son? Because, well, we do things that are wrong. We've done things that have gone against what God said we should do. We've done things what we call sins, or things that we've done wrong, and we needed forgiveness. And so God sent Jesus Christ, and Jesus died on the cross to save us from our sins and then rose from the dead. And he says if we believe in him, that we'll be forgiven of all those things that we've done wrong and be saved. And that's it. We can tell people that, just like we tell people at movies or vacations or anything else. We can do that. And that, like I said, that can change someone's life forever. That's a wonderful thing to be able to share. Something to think about. Let's say a prayer. You can repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for coming to us. Thank you for dying for us. And for raising from the dead. Help me to talk to others and share the wonderful things you have done, just like I talk to people about all the other great things in my life. Amen. All right. Well, go have an awesome day. We're still in the middle of a service, so you can stick around for the rest of the service. Then maybe afterwards, maybe you can watch Star Wars or whatever your favorite movie is. It'd be a fun thing to do today. All right. God bless.
Let's join together in singing our sermon hymn, which is How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Well, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If you'd please bow your heads and pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending your Son, for sending your Spirit. And we worship you, Lord, in Trinity. And we also look to you, Lord, as your church. We look to you for our hope, for our salvation, and for our mission. Lord, we pray that you would open our hearts and our minds to receive your word this morning. Be with me as I speak. Give me the words to say that I might preach faithfully. Lord, still all the distractions around us, that we would hear you. And pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our text for today is actually both. It's going to include a lot of the Acts reading that we had, but also this text here from Matthew chapter 28, 16 through 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth have been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the gospel of our Lord. So here we have that moment right before Jesus' ascension. And we talked about the ascension a couple of weeks ago. We've had a couple of big Sundays, right? It's been Ascension Sunday, Pentecost, now Trinity Sunday. And here we have Jesus preparing to ascend to the Father and also preparing to send his Spirit. Here we have the Trinity already there. And we're going to see that this whole thing that's going on here in our message is it involves the Trinity, even if we don't talk about it too much in that light. But Jesus is preparing to ascend, but he didn't leave us without direction. He didn't leave us. He didn't say, hey, guys, it has been great getting to know y'all. These past 3 years have been awesome. I'm going to go up to heaven for a while, and then I will see you again. He didn't do that. He didn't say, hey, I'm going to be gone for a while, so good luck. I hope it all goes well with you. No. He says, go. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. He gives direction. He gives a clear mission. Go make disciples of all nations. It's clear and it's simple. It's short. It's something we can remember. Go make disciples. Okay. Do it of all nations. All right. Got it. So that is what we are here to do. And that is really is the mission of every church. It's the mission of our church. It's the mission of every church. I remember the first time I was putting together a mission statement for the first church start that I worked on. I was working with a coach. And he said, hey, this week, work on a vision statement and a mission statement. I was like, okay, I'll try to put something together. And so I was trying to work on some ideas, and I was struggling with it a little bit. And so I got a hold of him, and I said, hey, you know, I'm kind of having some trouble putting together a mission statement that doesn't just sound kind of basic. And he's like, yeah, he's like, I get that. It's because really, it's like, how many different ways can we say, go and make disciples? Because that's really what every church mission statement is. It's just said in different ways. And we kind of talked through it and worked on that a bit. But that is the mission of the church. We do it in different ways because every church is unique. And so some churches, they do big events. Other churches do a lot of interpersonal ministry. You know, there's different ways that churches do it. Right now, we're online. You know, and that's another way that people do this. But however it's done, at the root, at the base of it, it's always, go make disciples of all nations. That is the mission of the church. And it's interesting that as Jesus does this, as he gives this command, he says, go do this. And we read about this also in Acts, and in Acts we see a little bit more where he doesn't just say, go do it and get out there. It's not like, hey, you know, hit him on the back and go. He says, actually, hold off a second. Don't go quite yet. I want you to go do this, but for right now, go hang out in Jerusalem for a little while until I send my Spirit. And why does he do that? He does that because this is not just the mission of a bunch of guys and girls who are out going around trying to do something. Rather, this is his mission. This is God's mission. This is what God is all about, that he wants all people to hear his word and be saved. In fact, in 2 Peter 3:9, it says, the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. And also in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 4 to 6, it says, God desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. This mission is God's mission. It is his will that all should be saved. He wants his word to be out to all people, to all nations, that they might hear and believe. It's a simple mission. Go make disciples. And then he even tells us how. He even gives us those instructions. He says, how do you make disciples? Well, by baptizing and teaching. That's how we make disciples. We baptize and we teach. And sometimes we do it in that order. We baptize and then we teach. Sometimes we teach and then we baptize. Order isn't what's important, but we baptize and we teach. And so like with infants, we'll baptize first because we see the promises that God gives us about baptism, that in baptism you have forgiveness of sins, that in baptism you are buried with Christ and then raised with him in his resurrection. In baptism, he writes his name on us. All of these things, he claims us. And so we want that for our children, but it doesn't end there. Every now and then, I'll have someone come into the church and say, "Hey, you know, I'd like to baptize my child." Okay. So, what can we do to have our child baptized? And so, I'm like, "Well, let's talk about it, especially if they aren't a normal member, a regular member of the church." So, well, let's talk about this. And we don't just talk about what baptism is, but also about the fact that with baptism, that's not supposed to just be the end. In other words, I don't want you to just come in, have your child baptized, and then never see you again, because the teaching still needs to happen. We baptize and we teach. And so that child needs to be raised in the faith, needs to be taught about Jesus and about all that he has commanded. And to not do that is, well, it's bad for the child, it's bad for the family, bad for the church. We're missing out on that person who to be growing up in the church and being a part of this. So we baptize and we teach. And sometimes we teach and then we baptize. That's usually how we do it with adults. And that's what we see here with Peter. It's kind of interesting, right? That they send, or Jesus sends out and he says, "Wait until you know, wait here in Jerusalem until I send my Spirit." And as soon as the Spirit comes, what do? They go out and teach. As soon as the Spirit comes, they go out and teach. So that's what we are to do. We are to go out and teach. But what are we supposed to teach? Well, let's take a look at Peter's message, and I think we can get a good idea of what we are to teach. So how does he start? He starts by saying, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know." So he starts by establishing who Jesus is. Jesus is from God. He is the Messiah. He is the one that God has sent. That's who Jesus is. And he even says, you've seen what he did. You've seen the signs. And of course, they've been around. Today, we would say, look at the signs that are written here in the Word. Look at all the things that he did. This is not just an ordinary guy. This is someone who has come from God. Now, in the day of Peter here, when he's talking, he just starts with, hey, Jesus is from God, because the people that he's talking to, they already understand that there's a God. In fact, in that day of age, that was just assumed. That was known. People saw creation all around them. They said, yeah, there's a God. Now, the discussion was, well, who's God? You know, who is it? Is it the people that the Romans worship or the Jews worship? Who is God? That was where the discussion was. And so he starts with Jesus is from God. Today, however, we live in a little bit different situation where there are many who don't even realize that there is a God. Many say, no, I don't think there's a God. And so we may need to start to kind of take a step back and start a little earlier and say, hey, there is a God. He created all this around you. He created you. He created me. And then he sent Jesus Christ. Jesus came from God, that same God who created all things. So we may start there, but then we also proclaim, just like Peter did, that Jesus is from God. So then why did Jesus come? Why did God send Jesus? Why did the Father send Jesus? Well, what does he say next? He says, this Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. Kind of hits him right in the nose there, doesn't it? Yeah, so Jesus was from God. You saw all the signs and wonders that he did, right? Yeah, and then you killed him. You killed the one whom God has sent. You went against God. You sinned against God. Now, to be sure, as he says here, this was all according to God's plan. You didn't thwart God here. You didn't throw him off or anything. God knew this was going to happen. God planned for this to happen. But you went against God. You crucified, you killed the Son of God. They're sinners. And in fact, later on in this same chapter, it says that they heard these things and they were cut to the heart. In other words, they felt the weight of their guilt. They felt the shame. They said, what do we need to do? So there's a God. He sent Jesus. Why did he send Jesus? Because we're sinners. You're a sinner, I'm a sinner. And that needs to be a part of the message too. Why do we care about the fact that God sent Jesus Christ? Well, because we need him. Because we've done things that are against God. Sure, you didn't crucify Jesus, but you've gone against God. You've done things that were against his word. You've done things that you knew in your heart were wrong. In your conscience, you knew it. And that breaks that relationship with God. That puts us in a place where we deserve death. And I'm in the same place. All have sinned and fallen short. This isn't something where we go around shaking our fingers at people saying, look what you did. You sinned. You're the bad one. No, we're all in the same boat. We're all sinners. We all need Jesus. It's a different way to come at people. Rather, we're giving something that we have been given. We're saying, hey, look, this is available to you too. I needed it, and so do you. So there's a God. He sent Jesus Christ, the Son. Why did he send him? Because we're sinners, every one of us. But Jesus not only died on the cross. If that was the end of the story, this would be a very sad story, but it wasn't. Rather, as Peter continues, God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death because it was not possible for him to be held by it. Jesus was raised from the dead. In that we see that he overcame death. We see that his sacrifice has been accepted, that our sins can be forgiven. He has been victorious. And what a beautiful thing, what an amazing thing that is. God created everything, we sinned against him, but he sent his son to die on the cross and be raised again for you. So that you can be forgiven, so that you can be made right with him, so that all of those sins that you've done can be washed away. That's the message we bring. And there's one more component to this, and this was a little outside of the reading that we had for this week, but it's in Acts 2, verses 37 to 41. It says this, now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. And Peter said, and they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off. That's you and me, by the way. Everyone whom the Lord has called to himself. And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. So those who received his word and were baptized, there were added about 3,000 souls that day. 3,000, that's a lot of baptisms. That would have been awesome. That would have been so awesome to see. But that's what happens. We go out, we tell people about Christ. We say, look, there's a God. He created everything. He sent Jesus because we're sinners. And Jesus died on the cross. He rose from the dead. And the question is, what do I do? If I hear this and I believe this, what do I do? Repent and be baptized, every one of you. And we share that. What do you do now? Now that you know that you're a sinner, now that you know that Jesus died on the cross for you, you believe. Repent and be baptized, every one of you. It's really not that complicated of a message. God created everything. He sent Jesus Christ because we're sinners. We've all done things that are wrong. But Jesus died on the cross. He rose from the dead to pay the price for our sins, overcoming death. And if we believe, repent, and are baptized, we shall be saved. Our sins are forgiven, and we receive the Holy Spirit. That's the message. Now, there's a lot more in the Bible. There's a lot more that we teach, absolutely. But at the core of it, at the thing that we are trying to share with people who don't yet know Jesus, is that gospel message. And we can do that. Every one of us can do that. It's what we've received. We're just telling our story. We're telling our story to someone else who's in the same place so that they can also make that their story. So they can hear about the forgiveness and the grace of Jesus Christ that they so desperately need, just like we did. At the Ascension, God gave the mission. At Pentecost, He gave the power through the Holy Spirit, and now we live on that mission. We too have been sent. Go. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them all that Christ has commanded. We can do this. That mission is God's mission. It's our mission. It's your mission. It's my mission. And it's a wonderful thing to be able to give that gift of the Word of God to someone. And so that's what we do. And it's kind of cool. Here on Trinity Sunday, we see all these aspects of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit working through the mission of the church. I mean, it was the Father who sent the Son. It was the Father and the Son who sent the Spirit. And now Jesus sends you and me with the Spirit on the mission that is the Father's. To baptize in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And teach all that He has commanded. So we praise Him for that. We celebrate our triune God. And then we go tell others about it. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for sending Jesus. We thank You for sending Your Spirit. And we thank You for sending us. Lord, embolden us. Strengthen us. Give us opportunities and then give us the words to say. Lord, it is You who works faith in the hearts of people. It is You who is at work. Lord, You only call us to go out and tell people. You're the one who takes care of the results. So we have nothing to fear. We have nothing to fear. Lord, help us to see the need and then to give what is needed, which is that gospel message of Jesus Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's join together in professing our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. And as we do this, this here again is another way that we tell that gospel message. So if you know the Apostles' Creed here again, you know the message of Jesus Christ to be shared. Let's join together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's join together in prayer. We're going to do the prayers of the church. And at the end of each petition, I'm going to say, Lord, in Your mercy, if You please respond with hear our prayer as You pray along with us. And ask that You would keep in Your prayers all of those who are affected by the floods. As we've gotten a ton of rain, and so there's been some issues with flooding that's going on. Pray that You would keep them in Your prayers. Also, we've prayed in the past for Judy's friend Nancy, who was diagnosed with a brain tumor, she also now has received word that the cancer has spread, and so she's declining treatment. And so we lift up her and her family as they go through this time, and continue to pray for healing, but also for comfort and trust in what the Lord will do. So let us pray. O blessed and holy Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, please hear our prayers. In the beginning, Father, your word spoke all things into being, and from nothing you made all that is. Help us to see the imprint of your love in the goodness of creation, and to exercise responsible care for all that you have entrusted us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, fill us with your Spirit that we might hear the voice of your word and respond with faith, confessing you without fear before all manner of people and in every corner of the earth, and also living according to your commands all of our days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, raise up in your church godly men to serve as her pastors, as well as faithful teachers and church workers, to make known your saving gospel. Raise up all of us as faithful servants to heed your call and to serve you to the best of our ability wherever you may place us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In government and law, Father, you work to establish and preserve order, protecting the weak and fostering godly true virtue. Bless our president, our governor, and all who make and administer and judge our laws. Deliver the world from threats of pandemic and tyranny, and preserve the nations in peace. Bless all who defend us in the armed forces and the law enforcement. Aid us in emergency, bless all those who aid us in emergency and medical fields, and also those who inform us with news. Hinder those who would oppress any peoples with mistruth, violence, or fear. And also, Lord, we pray that you would be with those who are dealing with the flood from this storm, especially those folks who are in Louisiana and Alabama who are still facing this storm. Watch over them, protect them, and may the church be there to help them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And in our hour of trial, Lord, in the moment of trouble, you are there. You hear us when we pray. And Lord, we ask that you would be with the sick, with the troubled in mind, with the wounded in heart, and with those who grieve. Lord, we especially lift up Nancy and ask that you would heal her, that you would comfort her and her family, and that she would look to you in this time. Lord, we also ask that you would continue to be with Aaron as he deals with kidney stones, that you would break them up, that you would end this pain that he's in, Lord. Be with the doctors and the nurses as they treat him. And Lord, we also lift up all those whom we name in our hearts and our minds at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you send us your Spirit, who is the great comforter. This year, Lord, has seemed like one hit after the next. We've had pandemics, we've had political turmoil, we've had social unrest and racial injustice. Lord, it is a lot to deal with. We lift up all those who are struggling with this, as I think we all are. Dealing with anxiety, fear. We're trying to figure out how best to proceed in a world that seems like it's changing every single day and nothing seems firm. Lord, give us your peace. Strengthen us in our faith. Lord, beyond all of these things that are going on in the world, we are also dealing with individual struggles and trials, Lord. Help us to turn to you. But Lord, more we know that you come to us. Lord, fill us with your Spirit. Strengthen us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this hour of worship, Father, you serve us with gifts of your grace that have forgiven us, that we might know the gift of a clear conscience, and as redeemed, we might honor you with all that we think, say, and do. Accept the sacrifice of our praise and the tithes and offerings that we bring. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else we need, we pray that you would give us, Father, for the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, through whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, both now and forevermore. Amen. Let us join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Well, let's join together in our closing song, which is Where You Go, or sorry, which is I Will Follow. It starts with Where You Go. Well, thank you. Thank you all once again for being a part of our worship here today. I pray that you are blessed by this time and surely blessed by the work of God and forgiveness of sins and just through his word. We have a couple of announcements before we get going here. First of all, I know for many of you, worship includes giving. That's part of the worship experience that you have, Lord, folks. And just want to let you know that there is a way to do that online with Faith. So if you go to faithwesleychapel.com, there's a link up in the top right that says Give. If you click on that, you can give, I think, by credit card, debit card, or check. You can also, of course, mail it in to the church as well. But just wanted to let you know that is available for you, for those of you who have that as a part of your worship time. A few other things to note. On Thursday night, we are continuing our time of prayer. That's something that we do Facebook, YouTube, and on the Faith Wesley Chapel website. And so I encourage you to come out. We've kind of expanded our topic, if you will, expanded what we're praying about. Now, not only just the pandemic, but also racial injustice and the social unrest right now that we're seeing, and trying to keep all of these things as well as each other in our prayers. And so with that, know that you can submit prayer requests, and I encourage you to do that. And those prayer requests will be included during those Thursday evening prayers. So if you go to, again, the Faith Wesley Chapel .com website, there is a link there to submit prayer requests that you can do, and we will include those. We do have the Growth Group Bible Study on Zoom on Friday, so that's going to be at 7 o'clock on Friday. It's a Bible study. We've been going through the Book of Romans. You don't have to have been going through it with us up until now. You can jump in at any point, and we'd love to have you being a part of that. And so if that's something you'd like to do, I know I saw here we've already had the Contact Us link on Facebook, at least, that you can let us know, because that we have to send out the Zoom information via email just because of the security stuff. But if you contact us through faithwesleychapel.com or send me an email at kurt@faithwesleychapel.com, we'd be happy to get you on that mailing list so that you can be a part of that Bible study. We also, of course, have a mailing list to send out all the things that we're doing and information about what's going on. We have our service, of course, next week at 11:30 a.m., as it always is. We're going to continue this message series of being sent while looking at the harvest that God has prepared for us. And then immediately after that, we have a congregational voter meeting. So, was it, I think, last week, we had a congregational meeting where we talked about coming back and into in-person worship and how we were doing that, as well as whether we wanted to start having our worship time at 11 a.m. And so we're going to have a vote as to whether we want to move that time. And so I encourage all of our voting members to be a part of that. That Zoom information will be sent out this week so that you can be on that. That's going to happen right after the service. Excuse me. All right. So I think that is it. I'm trying to think if I'm forgetting anything, but of course, how would I remember? All right. I think that's all. So go in peace and serve the Lord, and have a great week. God bless.